I can't see the islands, I can't see the beach, I can't see the waves, but I can hear them. It's quite eerie because I can hear the rumble of the sea, but I can't see it. Mm. And where I look down on it every morning, it's quite beautiful in a strange sort of a way.
Did you catch a few fish through the week?
Oh, Hammo, I must tell. I'll save it all up for next week, but... Oh, gee, I caught some crackers this week. Absolutely. One of the best weeks I've had for years, I reckon. And it's because there's a bit of swell, there's, you know, some pretty big waves, and that stirs the fish up. When it's too calm, you don't, you know, if you're comfortable, you don't catch fish. You've got to be uncomfortable. And I was uncomfortable, and I caught some absolute crackers. Beautiful snapper. Oh, dear. Even emperor, which you very rarely catch. Kingfish all over the place, which I don't particularly like. And I caught a salmon. I made these beautiful fish cakes. I've had an absolute ball this week.
Now, Stinky, you've got a presentation on today. Quickly tell me about that.
Oh, because I'm a mad keen historian, local historian, Hammo. And I give presentations to different groups, and I really enjoy it. I really do enjoy it, of telling people what I've learned about the local pioneers. So I'm doing a talk to the family history group here in Nelson Bay today, and we have a good old yarn, a cup of tea, and talk about the pioneers to the district.
Okay, sounds like fun. We've got to keep it brief today, mate, because we've just had this processing this news on the death of Shane Warne today. So we will talk in some more detail next week. Thanks for having a chat.
Hello, Hammo.
There's Stinker Clark, who joins us at this time every Saturday morning right now. It's time for the latest ABC News.
Cindy Bryce with ABC News. The Australian cricket team has found out the news of Shane Warne's death in the middle of a historic test series in Pakistan. South Asia correspondent Avani Dias reports from Islamabad.
Under tight security, surrounded by military personnel and helicopters, the Australian cricket team has learned the tragic news of Shane Warne's death. Players were resting ahead of the second day of Australia's first test match to be played in Pakistan in 24 years. On behalf of the team, Pat Cummins said the team is devastated by the news and that many players got into the sport because of Shane Warne. Pakistani cricketing legend Shoaib Akhtar, who played against Shane Warne for more than a decade, said he was the finest cricketer of all time with a very large heart. Avani Dias, ABC News, Islamabad.
Warne took 708 test wickets and is widely regarded as the greatest leg spinner to ever play the game. England captain Joe Root says he's struggling to come to terms with the news.
It's hard to know what to say, really, and my experiences of Shane were as someone that absolutely loved the game of cricket. It was always a joy to be around. Gave so much energy to the sport. And obviously, as a kid growing up, was a massive idol of mine. Someone who wanted to emulate.
International monitors say radiation levels at Ukraine's largest nuclear power plant remain stable after it was seized by Russian forces. North America correspondent Jade McMillan reports.
Ukrainian authorities have accused Russia of nuclear terrorism, arguing its forces attacked the Zaporizhia plant, causing a large fire which has since been extinguished. The Director General of the International Atomic Energy Agency, Rafael Mariano Grossi, has told an emergency meeting of the UN Security Council, safety systems are intact.
We consider from a technical point of view that operation continues normally.
Russia has blamed the fire on Ukrainian saboteurs. Jade McMillan, ABC News, Washington.
Former New South Wales Police Minister Troy Grant has broken down outside Newcastle Courthouse after his father was sentenced yesterday to nearly 4 years in jail for a drunken hit and run in the Hunter region. Kenneth Grant will have a non-parole period of 2 years for hitting and killing 62-year-old Tony Greenfield after a Christmas party near Maitland in 2019. Grant, a former police inspector, was intoxicated and claimed no memory of the event. Troy Grant said his father will face a tough time in jail.
My sister and I will just pick up the pieces at the end, but I don't want to for a second compare that to the pieces that the Greenfields are picking up. They're the, generally the ones that Kim and I are genuinely sad for.
Plans are gaining momentum for a school expansion at Cessnock, accommodating more than 400 extra students. Giselle Wakatama reports.
The St Philip's Christian College Cessnock campus expansion is considered a state significant development and valued at more than $70 million. Plans are before the state government and on exhibition until mid-March. The work's planned over five stages, comprising of alterations and additions to existing buildings and construction of seven new buildings. They'll be used to provide for children in kindergarten to year 12 and also include the Dale Special School. It will see student numbers increase to more than 1,600. There'll also be a new aquatic centre with two swimming pools, co-located with a trade training centre and a new performing arts centre.
In sport, Australia's men's cricket team has taken just one wicket on the opening day of its test series against Pakistan. Pakistan will resume its first innings at 1 for 245 on day two of the first test in Rawalpindi this afternoon. Imam Al-Haq is unbeaten on 132 and Azhar Ali is on 64. Australia's acting coach Andrew McDonald says the home side has batted impressively so far.
I think you've got to give credit to the way that Imam, Shafiq and Azhar Ali batted. I mean, they made a few errors, gave us a few wins, and they were really, really disciplined. So something that we can look into as we try to navigate through the game as well with the bat.
In A-League Women's, the Newcastle Jets were thumped 5-1 by Brisbane Roar last night at No. 2 Sports Ground. Larissa Crummer scored a hat-trick for the Roar. The Jets' only goal came from Lauren Allen in the second half. Newcastle is sitting in 8th spot on the ladder. Meanwhile, the men's side takes on Western United in Ballarat this afternoon. That's the latest from ABC News.
Spend your Saturday with Craig Hamilton
on ABC Newcastle.
It's 24 minutes to 7 and it's great to be with you today on the program. If you would like to ring me, you can. The number is 1-300-33-1233, turning outside leg stump, unplayable. Hard to argue with that, Campbell. You might have some reflections now. Today, I'm sure that as the cricket world and the sports world in general comes to terms with the news we've heard overnight, there will be reflections and commentary on this developing and shocking story. 0487 99 1233. We will keep you up to date, of course, every hour on the flood situation and where what you need to know in your area as far as river heights are concerned and whether there is a chance of minor, moderate or heavy flooding. This stage doesn't appear to be any heavy flooding in our region anywhere, but it's possibly moderate or minor flooding, but we will keep you up to date with all that information each hour. And Dungog has come under our notice, as it has on a few occasions in previous years when it's come to floodwaters. Sarah Crawford joins us for Hunter Roundup today, and Sarah's on the ground in Dungog. Not only will tell us what's happening in Dungog, but we'll be able to report on the conditions there as well. So stay tuned.
Catastrophic floods have destroyed homes and livelihoods across New South Wales. For thousands affected, the cleanup and long journey to recovery is only just beginning. If you would like to donate to flood-affected communities, head to your local ABC Radio website and click on How Can You Help to see a list of organisations accepting goods and donations for those in need. Keep up to date with your local flood warnings on ABC Radio, your emergency broadcaster.
Lady, well, laying down the world, laying down the world.
Shot in the dark. That's ACDC at 18 to 7. You're on ABC Radio. Newcastle, Craig Hamilton with you today on the program. Always welcome your call. 0487 99 1233 is our text line.
The latest news every hour.
Newcastle's medical fraternity is rallying behind a health facility that helps cancer patients as they prepare for major surgery.
A Newcastle pharmacist says demand for rapid antigen tests has dropped in recent weeks.
People of Ukrainian heritage in Newcastle have spoken of their worry and sadness at the events unfolding in Europe.
Newcastle Knights fullback Kalen Ponga has been unveiled as the new team captain.
Keeping you informed, this is ABC Newcastle.
If you can see it later on, but yeah, it's just a matter for this fog to lift before we can see what's happening out there. Still no ships anchor off port. Down at Swansea Heads, east winds at 3 knots. The bar is rough, 1 metre seas on a 2 to 3 metre swell, and Port Stephens a light westerly at 3 knots. Inside waters choppy, occasional break on the shoals. Pressure steady in 1006. Currently 22 degrees on the beach. Quite a few people up early exercising, but surf wise, yeah, looks a little bit choppy and tending to close out. Maybe a bit of an improvement on the high tide, but looks like tomorrow we should have some offshore winds before a southerly change.
Have a great weekend.
Certainly will.
Dave Anderson down on the beach.
Screaming Jets.
Or Sammy White. Demi Mitchell.
And Morgan Evans.
ABC Newcastle.
Supporting your local.
Making news this hour, tributes flow for spin king Shane Warne after his shock death in Thailand. The New South Wales Premier to visit flood-ravaged Lismore. And Newcastle Pride gets ready for Mardi Gras. Good morning, Bindi Bryce with ABC News. Cricket Australia has paid tribute to Shane Warne, describing him as a true cricketing genius who was one of the most talented and charismatic players ever witnessed. Yvette Gray reports.
Only yesterday, Shane Warne posted on social media a tribute to another cricketing legend, Rod Marsh, who also died after suffering a heart attack. News of Warne's death overnight has left cricket fans all over the world in shock. Cricket Australia CEO Nick Hockley says Warne was loved and admired for his unbelievable bowling skills, his humour, warmth and engaging personality. He says he had an extraordinarily astute understanding of the game and his influence and legacy will last for as long as it is played. After retiring from playing professional cricket, Melbourne-based Warne remained heavily involved in the sport he loved as a coach and commentator.
News of Warne's death broke shortly after play had finished on the opening day of Australia's first test in Pakistan. Australia's men's test captain Pat Cummins says the players are in shock.
There's so many guys in this team and squad who, you know, still hold him as a hero, their all-time favourite player, and the loss that we're all trying to wrap our heads around is huge.
Several communities in northern New South Wales and near Sydney remain flooded. Residents in low-lying properties of Crokey on the mid-north coast have been ordered to evacuate. 5 deaths have so far been confirmed in the state. Ryan Clarkston from the SES says crews are still assisting in flood-inundated areas.
We're still very much in a flood response phase on the Hawkesbury River and up around Ballina and several parts of the north coast, particularly along the Richmond River. However, during Friday, crews had the opportunity to get in and conduct over 800 rapid damage assessments around Lismore, which gives an opportunity to start prioritising where the recovery and clean-up work needs to be done.
New South Wales Emergency Services Minister Steph Cook has been appointed to the new position of Minister for Flood Recovery. It comes as the Premier Dominic Perrottet plans to visit the flood-ravaged town of Lismore today. Gary McKinnon from Resilience New South Wales has been appointed the Recovery Coordinator for the state's north. The Crisis Policy Committee has also been stood up, which will be responsible for overall policy direction. Overseas, and Russia's attack on Ukraine's biggest nuclear power station has been labelled a war crime. Europe correspondent David Lipson has more from London.
Russian forces are now in control of the Zaporizhzhia nuclear power plant in central Ukraine, which provides close to a quarter of the country's electricity. The facility was shelled, sparking a fire, but the reactors are intact and there's no sign of increased radiation. Ukraine's president described it as nuclear terror that could have unleashed six Chernobyl disasters on Europe. The US embassy in Kyiv called it a war crime. Russia blamed the attack on Ukrainian saboteurs, but didn't provide any evidence. David Lipson, ABC News, London.
A special meeting of the United Nations Security Council has condemned Russia for putting the nuclear power plant at risk. UN spokesman Rosemary DiCarlo says the attack should never have happened.
Military operations around nuclear sites and other critical civilian infrastructure are not only unacceptable, but highly irresponsible. Ukraine knows only too well the devastation of a major nuclear accident. The Chernobyl disaster stands as a lasting example to avoid a catastrophic nuclear incident.
Back home, and Newcastle police say residents in Annie Street at Wickham will have to wait before they can return home as demolition gets underway on two wool store buildings. Residents were evacuated on Tuesday when a massive fire tore through the historic buildings, which were left structurally unstable. Demolition crews began the delicate operation to bring the buildings down yesterday, and Newcastle Police Commander Wayne Humphreys says it'll take at least 10 days to complete. He says the job can't be rushed.
No, absolutely. That's too dangerous. Absolutely too dangerous, particularly given the proximity of the fuel farm. They're telling me 10 days. Could be longer because they've actually got to remove the material as well. But once we take off the top two to three levels of both buildings, then I'll probably allow Annie Street to totally repatriate.
New South Wales has confirmed its first human case of the Japanese encephalitis virus. Sarah Hawke reports.
The patient from the Victorian border region is in a stable condition in intensive care. New South Wales Health says several other patients are undergoing testing, with more cases expected. The virus is only spread by mosquitoes and is generally just found in far northern Australia. It can cause severe neurological illness. The virus has also been found at a number of pig farms. Health says it's working with the Department of Primary Industries to see the extent of the virus circulation. This is done through animal testing and mosquito monitoring. People have been urged to take measures to prevent mosquito bites.
The wet weather and COVID cases won't stop the 44th Mardi Gras parade taking place tonight. Phoebe Bowden reports.
The Sydney Cricket Ground will host 5,800 parade participants and 40,000 spectators for the annual Mardi Gras parade. Albert Kruger, CEO of Mardi Gras, says with the recent wave of Omicron cases, the SCG was the best option.
We've added even more bells and whistles and glitter and integration of activations, which is great. So we've had a practice run and now this one's going to be the best way ever.
Organisers say they hope the parade can return to Oxford Street next year when Sydney hosts World Pride.
The president of Newcastle Pride says this year's Mardi Gras parade is all about being united. Leanne McDougall says it's the fourth year the local group has joined the parade. It's been a tough few months for the LGBTIQ community as political debate focused on the rights of trans people. She says it'll be a chance to celebrate being together.
We are having an entry called Hand in Hand. So you'll see lots of sparkling capes from us with flags inside to represent all the wonderful community. Then we'll have some signs and hearts with all the flags as well and representing everyone in the community. So yeah, Hand in Hand.
Health experts have welcomed the federal government's new national obesity strategy, but warn it's crucial for Australians to understand the disease is a genetic condition. The new strategy aims to stop the rise in obesity in Australian adults and reduce it in children and teenagers by at least 5% by 2030. University of Melbourne Emeritus Professor Joseph Proietto says the new strategy must lead to effective treatment.
It's very important that we reduce the stigma against obesity because it is highly unfair, because you cannot develop obesity unless there is a gene, you're carrying a gene.
A protest that shut down the Year 12 photos at a school in Melbourne has led to a review of the school's uniform policy. The final year group photo at Elizabeth Murdoch College in Lang Warren was cancelled this week after several students were pulled out of the photo for having bright hair or piercings, and other students walked off in protest. The school has rescheduled the photo and is reviewing the policy. Year 12 student Akira Taylor says students should be allowed to express themselves.
After 2 years of being locked inside, not just trapped in our houses, but trapped in our heads, and we deserve to be loud, to be vibrant, we deserve to do that, and to express ourselves, express how we're feeling.
To sport, and a maiden test century to Imam Al-Haq has put Pakistan in a strong position heading into day two of the opening cricket test against Australia in Rawalpindi. Al-Haq will head back to the crease this afternoon on 132 not out, with Pakistan to resume its first innings on 1 for 245. Ajhar Ali is unbeaten on 64, while Abdullah Shafiq is the only batter out so far, caught by Pat Cummins off the bowling of Nathan Lyon for 44. Australia's acting coach Andrew McDonald says it's been a tough start to the series for the tourists.
Obviously a difficult day. It was always going to be in terms of who won the toss was probably going to get on their terms for day one. Really impressed with the way that we controlled the tempo of the game. That was one thing that we knew that we had to do so the game didn't run away from us on day one.
And Newcastle Jets coach Arthur Pappas says he looks forward to the challenge of playing the A-League ladder leaders. The Jets take on Western United in Victoria this afternoon. Western haven't been beaten in their past seven matches, with 5 wins and 2 draws. And looking at the Hunter's weather, partly cloudy with some light winds, a high chance of showers most likely tonight. The chance of a thunderstorm late this afternoon. Newcastle's heading for a top of 28 degrees. ABC News.
Spend your Saturday with Craig Hamilton
on ABC Newcastle.
Good morning, 10 past 7, and great to be with you today. As we heard in the news, if you're just waking up to the news that Australian legend, the greatest leg spinner that ever lived, Shane Warne, at the age of 52, has died of a heart attack in Thailand. The details at this stage are scant. It was first reported at 1 o'clock this morning.
Good morning, Bindi Bryce with ABC Hunter News. Tributes are flowing in for Australian cricket legend Shane Warne, who died while he was holidaying on an island in southern Thailand. Southeast Asia correspondent Mazoe Ford reports.
Royal Thai police on Koh Samui have told the ABC Shane Warne was staying with 4 people in a luxury villa before he died. Warne's body has been sent to Koh Samui Hospital, where an autopsy will be carried out. His friends are expected to speak to police officers later today. Last night, managers for the Australian cricketing great said he'd been found unresponsive in the villa after suffering a suspected heart attack, and despite the best efforts of medical staff, he couldn't be revived. Mazoe Ford, ABC News, Bangkok.
Cricket journalist Gideon Haig wrote a book on Shane Warne. He says Warne was admired and respected across the globe.
He was a genuine world cricketer. His reputation preceded him everywhere. And for a lot of people, a lot of foreign internationals, he was the kind of the personification of Australia and of Australian cricket.
Former New South Wales Police Minister Troy Grant says his father committed a reprehensible act in a drunken hit and run that left a 62-year-old man dead in the Hunter region. Kenneth Grant was yesterday sentenced to 4 years jail and will be eligible for parole in 2 years. He was heavily intoxicated when he killed Tony Greenfield near Maitland, who was walking by the road with his wife of 34 years. The court heard the incident has caused Mr. Greenfield's family unbearable pain. Troy Grant said his father's actions are inexplicable.
My dad and I spent our entire lives being advocates for road safety because we understand firsthand the devastation it causes, and we've lived the last couple of years on the wrong side of that.
The Bureau of Meteorology says parts of the Hunter's River systems will remain flooded over the weekend. There is major flooding at Gostwick Bridge from the Paterson River after peaking at just over 13 metres overnight, but the Bureau says the river is falling this morning. There is minor flooding at Raymond Terrace and Dungog. Moderate flooding is possible at Bolga later tonight along the Wollumbeyer Brook. The Bureau is forecasting heavy rainfall over the next couple of days and says there could be renewed flooding along the Paterson and Williams rivers. Newcastle police say efforts are stepping up to clear any loose asbestos from city streets after a massive warehouse fire spread the material over several inner city suburbs. The Wickham Wool Store buildings were gutted in the blaze on Tuesday, and the asbestos roofing was blown over a wide area. Newcastle Police Commander Detective Superintendent Wayne Humphrey says while the weather remains wet, specialist crews are combing the streets to ensure the contamination is cleared.
Our primary concerns are that the public streets that are littered with asbestos material get cleaned up while we've got the opportunity of everything still being wet and get it done quickly, because the greatest risk revolves around cars driving over that friable material and releasing of the fibres.
Newcastle City Council has warned that a delay on approved upgrade works at the historic Newcastle Ocean Baths could incur construction contract penalties. The Friends of the Ocean Baths Community Group are against plans to pour a concrete slab over the existing natural rock and sand floor of the pool. They argue it will detract from their swimming experience and the heritage value of the baths. The group has applied for an urgent interim heritage order to halt the works. A Newcastle trans woman marching in her first gay and lesbian Mardi Gras parade says it's a rite of passage and she's proud to have made it this far. Ashley Smith will be joining Newcastle Pride tonight, which is marking its fourth appearance at the Sydney event. Ms. Smith says she's been wanting to march at Mardi Gras for years and is ecstatic she's finally found the courage to take part.
A long time. I'm getting old, so more so the last couple of years since I've been on hormones. Like, I just think it's a bit of a destination and a bit of just completing the whole journey. I had struggled until I was older to come out transgender, and it's the right time. And I'm a bit scared of going in the cricket ground, but no, it'll be awesome.
Newcastle heading for a top of 28 degrees today with a shower or two, and there's a chance of a thunderstorm. That's the latest from ABC News. For more local stories, search ABC Newcastle News online.
Craig Hamilton
on ABC Newcastle.
Good morning, it's 25 to 8, and it's good to have you with us on the radio today. 1300 33 12 33 if you would like to give me a call this morning, or you can send a text in 0487 99 12 33. I'm asking you just to reflect on the life, the cricket career, Shane Warne this morning.